Hello, welcome you all for the second of the 10-day preamble lecture series. This is organized by a few student groups who have come under IITB for justice. Yesterday, Rubina spoke about the initial moments and the very many interesting tussles and battles that took place in crafting the constitution. Today, Mr. Tejendra, Pratap, Gautam is a PhD scholar with the Center for Policy Studies. He'll speak to us on another central idea that the constitution upholds of democracy. He'll primarily be speaking about democracy vis-a-vis questions of marginalization, humiliation, and our homegrown, absolutely intricate system of humiliation is, of course, caste. So he'll be talking about that in terms of what does the constitution do and what has been its life in the last 6-7 decades. But before we get to Tejendra, Ms. Aparna Ross will talk to us about the significance of the day in about 2-3 minutes. Yeah.
Today we begin our programs by commemorating the life and spirit of Rohit Vemula. It's been 4 years since the world, all of us, we students, lost a revolutionary who fought relentlessly against the Manuvadi forces running the academic campuses of this country. Many of us who were in this campus in 2016 vividly remember the night when the news of Rohit's demise spread. In the following days, hundreds of IITB students, without any active mediation, joined the Justice for Rohit movement. For several of them who had spent years beforehand in IITB, Rohit movement was special for another different yet related reason. Most of us carried a dead weight of silence around another institutional murder in our collective memory, which happened in 2014. Many of you might be aware of what happened with Aniket Ambore's life. Back then, the campus community here talked about Aniket's case as that of an accidental death. They wanted to prove that this was not a suicide. I have personally overheard and been part of conversations in the mess and hostel rooms where it was told that it was a wind that blew Aniket down a 6-story hostel building. In an inquiry report commissioned by the institute that took almost 1.5 years to come out, we witnessed efforts to individualize Aniket's case with implications that he suffered from depression due to severe academic pressure. On the other hand, Aniket's parents painstakingly chronicled their son's life in IIT Bombay campus in order to convince the administration that their son was systematically subjected to caste-based discrimination at the hands of a few professors and classmates. And sadly, students then couldn't mobilize themselves in order to seek justice for Aniket. This weight around unaddressed institutional murders, covert discrimination over one's identity, and a glaring lack of support system in terms of student groups and communities, particularly for Dalit assertion and representation, had since then been strongly felt among the students of this campus and united them in various fronts. Justice for Rohit movement of 2016 played a pivotal role in the mobilization of students within our campus. It's well known that IIT's way of fixing caste is through remedial measures and academic rehabilitation programs. The way of fighting caste stigma and discriminations is by instituting world-class counseling centers in their campuses. Aniket's life reminds us how these counseling centers and the very remedial programs could perhaps become tools to appropriate our experiences and translate them into medical terms and cumulative grade systems that have absolutely no connection with our lived realities. Merit, as often understood here, disqualifies the labor and histories of students availing reservation. Over the years, IITs have become grammatical spaces that constantly undermine reservation, a groundbreaking constitutional provision that ensures social justice to the marginalized sections of the country. Several student friends and activists of our campus hail from diverse communities and ideological backgrounds. They have been putting efforts to create spaces to get this campus talk about caste. It is true that we often have to forge solidarity under terms and conditions palatable to the majority of Savarna liberals of this campus. Even after an entire term of studying here, several of us are disillusioned because our activities have only just begun to find traction among the one section we always especially have tried to connect to. The undergraduate students from marginalized communities of this campus. The heavy fee structure and the hectic curriculum is designed in a fashion that not just issues of identity-based discrimination, but even the word politics is feared as a distraction. And this is where student leaders like Rohit Vemula and teachings of Mahatma Phule, Savitri Ma, Baba Saheb shine a light for many of us. We shout Rohit Abhi Bhi Zinda Hai in a Brahminical campus that is structurally designed to erase Dalit assertion and leadership. And in IITs, Dalit students are more susceptible to be alienated from their own community and cultural history because there are no traces of Dalit history and icons in their curriculum or in their shared social spaces. And student groups representing the marginalized communities of IIT Bombay campus require public support and lateral solidarity in their fight against imposition of Brahminical values and practices in academic spaces. We want more people to talk about caste through lived experiences and not through their entry category. I would like to conclude with a quote from a letter Aniket's mother, Mrs. Sunita Ambore, wrote to Srimati Radhika Vemula in 2016, and this was shortly after Rohit passed away. There is a part where this mother says, I quote, "When a person gets tired of fighting with powerful forces, only then is he overcome with an emptiness. This can be seen in my son's and Rohit's life. This is frightening for one who is sensitive, who thinks a lot and wants to realize his dreams. Such people, due to their nature, do not blame others, but come to a point when they are unable to go on anymore. They feel empty. Why would Aniket think so much? We always saw him laughing, performing and singing. What was there in IIT that my son forgot to smile? After his death, the doctor told us that Aniket was confused. But science and mathematics were his favorite subjects from the beginning, then how could he have become confused? Aniket had lost his identity and we feel very small in our own eyes. But Rohit's incident has once again highlighted the matter. Both Aniket and Rohit faced different conditions, but the reason they had to struggle was the same. I don't know till when will our children fight this hidden casteism. We too are fighting it. Students' agitation is the only remaining hope. Perhaps only the students will be able to wake up the dormant system." Here, students of IIT Bombay for Justice Forum would like to affirm that no student suicide is individual, they are socially orchestrated crimes to humanity. They are political acts of violence, they are institutional murders when systems meant for our emancipation fail to integrate the most marginalized amongst us and count them as dispensable. Let Rohit long live. Jai Bhim.
Thanks, Aparna. I now invite Tejendra to come. I asked him whether he'll speak for 40 minutes. He is deciding between either 20 minutes or 2 hours. As the chair, I will try to. No, I'm just joking. So he'll speak for about 40 minutes and then we'll have a discussion.
topic of today's discussion is democracy against caste. So this is the first slide, course. This is the symbolic representation where I'm meaning that the Constitution of India is now become a manusmriti by the virtue, and is going, the focus is now shifting from the constitutional values to the fascist values as we see our current times. So first I will walk you with some basic aspects of democracy and caste, then we will talk to further implications within a society, how downtrodden people has been subjugated by the caste atrocities. So if you see, what is the democracy? Basically, it's a derived from the term from demos, which means a people, and charity means a rule. A rule of people, as we say that the prajatantra. And in Athens, Western authors have suggested that the people that time has a very pluralistic society. They participated in a decision making as well as in a government processes. And they also denied that the Indian in India, there was no asset. But if we see a tribal system where we can see that the sabhas and samitis were there, and they were the kind of democratic society, or still living within a forest, and there are different communities like Baiga. And if you see in Maharashtra, Gadchiroli is one of the hottest bed where you can find a Maria Gund is also still living with their culture intact with the habitats. And in those times, governance system, king was considered as a protector of and defender of public life, which is not unlike today's time. So next slide is about now the transfer of democracy as visualized in a Western society is democratic in ancient, and then the thing is comes in the caste system. We see this is based on the origin of Brahma, where four varna came from Brahmins, from the mouth of Brahma, and from the Kshatri from the hand, and Vaishya from the janga, and then Sudra from the leg, and then it is our caste category within a caste system. If you see, Hindu caste system is based on a varna and caste, and denied a very existence of liberty, equality and fraternity. What today's constitution value is about, our constitution is Preamble, gives us a hope for liberty, equality and fraternity. But the very idea of fraternity is curtailed by the caste system, because it does not consider that the people can be united actually, because they are divided by the birth itself. So they are a fundamental concern. This is the a fundamental concern for a democracy also. If you see caste system versus and democracy, Ambedkar once said that the roots of democracy lie not in a form of government, parliament or otherwise. A democracy is more than a form of government. It is primarily a mode of associated living. The roots of democracy are to be served in social relationship, in the terms of associated life between people who form a society. It is very true, and indeed, if you see that after independence, that the kind of space has given to scheduled caste, scheduled tribe and other minorities by the people also. It is not that the people in India, they have not given a space to lower caste, but the atrocities is is not stopped also, and which is need to be inquired. If we see that the caste system is the very locus of all social problem of India. In the caste system, caste is a very constant factor which does not even change. If someone even change his religion, so society will always consider him as a lower caste. For instance, Ambedkar is still considered as a Dalit leader instead of a mass leader. Even he adopted the Buddha's teaching in life. The caste system does not allow for upward mobility in society. It is filled with inequality and injustice. The kind of system we are in, it is not that there are many things we have been seeing in present time. If we see that the communal violence kind of thing, which is also a precursor of caste system and continuously suppressing the section of people, even lower caste people could take weapons in their hand sometime. In practice, if we see that caste led us to human treatment of a vast population, presently 70% of Dalits constitute population of India, where within a minority, if you see tribal, Sikh, Muslim and other minority roughly constitute 85% of population, but still their demands, their life is still in threat because of very small number of people still drive this economy, this social society and even our decision making. To this day, the level of violence against Dalits and other lower caste is atrocious, and this social degradation perpetrated under the caste system has very few parallel in human history. Even if you see case of Rohit Vemula, which is died, he was very great scholar. For them, those committees are the hope, actually. Very few get a chance to study in a premium institutes like IIT Bombay, JNU and other institutions. But the education system which is now is producing and perpetuating the kind of violence is still not articulated well, because the most of the upper, if you see in IIT Bombay, most of the posts in teaching facilities is still held by upper caste, not lower caste. Percentage is still very low. By the constitution, we have some acts also, the Protection of Civil Rights Act 1977, and even though Prevention of Atrocities Act against SCST Act 1989. Last year we have seen when the governments try to abrogate or dilute some of provisions. So we have seen the Bharat Bandh also, and even the Constitution also gives us some fundamental rights like Article 14, Equality Before Law, which I don't see right now in present time, or Equal Protection of Laws, which is really not there in Delhi. If you see in JNU, or if you see Jamia Islamia, if you see UP in Ambedkar, Aligarh Muslim Universities, and Article 15, which gives the prohibition of discrimination on the grounds of religion, race, caste, sex or place of birth. This is also not true in present time also. The discrimination has been in case of JNU, which is the minorities has been perpetrated by the violence, and if you see that the Article 16, which gives the equality of opportunity in matters of public employment, it is totally not there, because it's still in government jobs there are no such reservation in if they have to, it is there, but it is not implemented enough by the government. So the idea of government is in a question that how we should understand the government also. And the Article 17 says that the abolition of untouchability and provision of its practice, it is also there in society. If we see very beginning of Chandrasekhar, which is a chief of Bhim army, because he belongs from the Saharanpur village, where atrocities perpetrated by the upper caste Thakurs in their place have from the long time, so that those people from their community get united and they revolt against the atrocities. So there is also that the idea of that now the revolt is happening from the lower strata also. I will not deny that it is not there. The idea of justice should be done by the constitution or by the government, it is not happening. And if you see Article 18 is abolition of title, except military and academia is there. This is the picture, if we remind ourselves, around 2016, the whole India got mesmerized by this. Like, this is not, this kind of image always haunted by this image. And in this case, people have tortured them because of they were lower caste and doing their job only. So the job has also removed, it's also not given the space in a society. It's now become their life threat also. And the work they are doing, they are not even now they are able to do that. So in conclusion, which I will say that the cruel truth of Indian society, that democracy has failed to give a proper shelter to lower caste folk within the framework of democratic governance. It is evident that the most of government decisions is still upheld by the upper caste majority government. In the present time, democracy has failed to serve the fundamental rights to lower caste. The kind of democracy has witnessed in those years in a majoritarian ways actually has been dominated by dominated every other identity. It is not that the Sidhui caste people have got suppressed in Muslims, tribals continue having seen suppression from the government. Most of the folks from minority and lower caste have suffered a lot. But the kind of atrocities lower caste people have seen, it is unimaginable in democratic society. Sometimes I imagine is really we live in a society which is really having a democratic value, because it questions our conscience also, that how we can imagine a society together. The collective which was imagined by the fathers of India, who constituted this very constitution of India, it is in under the threat actually. And then as a scholar, as a human being, like how we can understand that, how we can came together, how we can come together actually. And it is not the one day task that people have just emerged from the some vacuum. They have been keep fighting. They parallelly also, oppositions also work parallelly also. It is not that we have undermined them actually. So we have to also work together and walk together in order to fight against the such majoritarian thoughts and people which have a very millennial, different kind of thoughts in case of Una, Gujarat, if we see, just two, three days ago, this news came that they have demanded from the president, please devote them to a country where they do not face discrimination. This anecdote explains that the basic idea of democracy has been evaporated from the Indian society. It is really that this India does not, either this India, whatever it is India, is there. It can't hold us, or we have to go somewhere else. I don't know. Or I, or like minorities, those who's facing atrocities. Because if we don't have a space for our basic rights, or they are demanding, it means it is alarming situation. It is not that the justice is not there at all. So whatever we are seeing, that the democracy we are living, it is against now everyone, every minority actually. It is not a particular one, it's not about a scheduled caste or scheduled tribe. Because their idea is now become this. They want to saffronize everyone. Thank you.
Thanks, Tejendra, for that eloquent indictment of who we are as a people and what does a constitution mean in a deeply inegalitarian society, and what are the limits of constitution making, constitutionalism, etc. He did not take even the allotted time, so we have lot of time to talk about. I just want to flag two, three concerns and questions that he has placed before us. He began with the counterposing constitution with Manusmriti. It has been written about. There is scholarly work around that. This counterposing is not merely scoring an easy point. There are interesting ways in it. For instance, a scholar called Nicholas Jarls has done absolutely interesting work about what do Ambedkar statues mean in Uttar Pradesh villages. People who are absolutely disenfranchised with very little resources, put together whatever kind of money they can and put up an Ambedkar bus. What does it mean to the ways in which we think about what is our public space? One of the astounding remarks somebody makes, one of his respondents makes is, can we even count the number of Gandhi statues we have, Nehru statues we have? So this statue, putting a statue, we now increasingly know about whose statue is higher. It's not, there is clearly a bravado around that, but it's also a certain making of what is plausible, what is possible, what is doable in that public space. So there is interesting ways in which, what is very interesting about the ways in which the Dalit community in India has approached constitution is we know that in terms of the developmental indicators the Dalit population is amongst the most backward so literacy has only recently in the last generation or two has become something that is available, basic kind of education that has become available. But what Nicholas Jarls, for instance, talks about, I think that's a very interesting way of thinking about it, is that for a more or less an unlettered kind of population, not really well-educated population, the kind of investment that this community has had in what is actually an elite document, constitution. You know? So the kind of everyday humiliations that routinely is imposed on marginalized has not changed because we have had this wonderful constitution. So, but notwithstanding that, the kind of investment that this community has on this book, which perhaps not many of them were able to read and understand, is actually absolutely interesting and unprecedented. It's not, you know, available anywhere else at all. So that Manusmriti, the meanings that Manusmriti has as against what does, so it is actually an invitation that the marginalized communities have placed before the nation, that let us work towards equality, let us work towards democracy, fraternity, can we actually begin to see one another as equals, etc. And clearly, we know that we have miserably failed in taking that challenge on, while you know, we continue to look at the Dalits as somehow the beneficiaries of it. Actually, they are the challengers, you know, challengers to this very idea of nation. I think that's a very interesting thing to talk about and begin to think about what does democracy even mean. When caste continues to, in absolutely nuanced ways, it's brilliant, you know. Caste system is, in, if you were to be fascinated, it's one of the most brilliant ways in which we can deny very human existence and dignity. So I don't think there is any other system which can parallel to the extent, to the levels, to the nuances that we have gone in making this possible. What does it even mean when, you know, when we say we have democracy, and you know, so therefore, what is then this investment in constitution itself? Every day now, it has become another sacred thing to stand, and we resented about other kinds of impositions that the nation state made, and now we are forcing ourselves to stand for, you know, when the preamble is being recited, it has become another national anthem now. But what is that investment about is something interesting to, I think about. Yeah, so the other interesting thing that he alluded to is to this relationship between religion and caste. That actually feeds into projects of constitution making, imaginaries of a certain majoritarianism that we were moving towards, some of the routes that we did not take and we should have taken, for instance, in the 1930s, but we could actually come back to this relationship between religion and caste, Hinduism and caste, etc. Yeah, so the last, I think he alluded to that, I think again something that we must force ourselves to ask, which is something that I began with, is what is the relationship between formal law and the ethical relationships that we must, you know, forge amongst the people that we find ourselves in. You could make hundreds of laws, and for a very long time, perhaps, you know, a certain sense of whether it's vote bank, whether it's a commitment to casteless order, the state was willing to make more and more laws, you know. So, but as long as our ethical kind of disposition towards one another does not change, our law can only go so far. And, you know, so that's the other thing to think about: law, constitution, and you know, ethical behavior towards one another, etc. So these are some of the things that have come up. You could bring up other things. He is great with his Hindi, so if somebody wants to speak in Hindi, I will refuse to open my mouth in Hindi, but he can speak, so it's also open to you know, Hindi.
For the caste system, that is reservation or affirmative action, but that thing has not, has it been useful to curb the casteism? Because the people who have risen in the society, who are from SCST communities, and they have risen in the society, like I come from SCST background, and I have come to IIT Bombay. So I think that do you think that the people who have risen in the society and taken advantage of reservation and completed their higher studies should voluntarily give up reservation in favor of those who are from the same community and they don't even know about reservation, or the perks of reservation don't reach them? So and let's address the elephant in the room, because many people are in IIT Bombay from SCST communities. They live in their high castle and they themselves practice casteism with those who whom they consider as lower castes. So do you think this continuation of reservation without addressing this fact that the people who have risen, practice casteism, how can we eradicate that and how can we reduce that?
It's a collective conversation. People can come in and respond to one another. It's not up to
the burden of answering. So I will try, give you first answer that reservation is not a remedy for abolishing a caste system, okay, which you are referring. It is about to upliftment of lower caste people from the as a given a chance in a political, social, or basically economical and political, so that they can come up in a more in society as a economical basis. And the very constitution is also ask for your caste certificate, which is as a government document which says that you are belong from this community or this caste. So this, as long as this caste certificate system is there, you are not going to be treated like within a constitutional framework. It is not democratic in itself, actually. In order to give a facility to them, but it asks for your own identity and also gives a promise to your identity will be abolished. It's a little problematic, okay. And second thing, if people whosoever have got the chance in last 73 years of after post independent that they have a job, it is really their responsibility that they should do, because until unless up, it is there the current politics in India is a caste based politics. We give our votes on the conscience of caste only. And if we see this idea that the practice of religion is not going to abolish from the scheduled caste. If we see that, because we have idealized Ambedkar, we have idealized Kansi Ram. If Mayawati dies, she will become a Devi or something. She already made his Murti. Okay, so we are worshipper of idols. Some way and another way we started doing this also. We never believe in the values or the teachings of something. Now, if we really want to, we have to practice those teachings. So practicing a teaching is very hard. Practicing an idol is very easy. You have to go and namaste karna two times in a day. That's it. The same way we do against in Hindu system also. The idea is different, but there is also things.
So, partially addressing what you said, till very recent I used to think that was my personal belief, that reservation is something that should be, that is most beneficial when given at the lowest level of education, let's say primary schools and secondary schools. And not in the higher education or in jobs and in job opportunities. But now, as you also mentioned, that there is a local politics also at play. If you go at workplaces, if you come at an institution like IIT, one thing I also noticed that all the professors, like at least in my department, I've seen that many of them are from upper caste. And we don't have many people from marginalized backgrounds. So taking that in consideration, I don't think that giving up education, even at places like this, is going to serve the purpose. Because, like we already discussed, that if we have not imbibed the democratic values that we vouch for, you know, during the time of independence and after the making of constitution, so until and unless we don't really work on the democratic values and we have not embraced it truly, so I don't think that giving up reservation is actually going to solve the problem. And about the replication of how people from, when a person from marginalized community, when he or she has risen, and how they start to kind of imitate what they have seen as an ideal person. So I will just take example of Paulo Freire's, he wrote extensively on in the pedagogy of the oppressed, about how the oppressor, they start to emulate the oppressed, because for him or her, it, that image is the ideal image that the person has always seen. So I think the problem is slightly different here. So but my point is that giving up education at higher levels also is, I don't think is going to solve the problem. But I don't know what is the other way out. But yeah, that's my personal opinion.
So adding on to Karishka's point, the point is that we have had centuries of oppression, and two generations of reservation is not going to them. Going to cut it out. Okay, so it is going to take time. Till the time you say that, okay, I have risen enough, or I have risen for two generations, and I think now people who are still downtrodden deserve a chance, and I can compete in the, or yeah, not compete, but I can survive by not keeping my identity as central.
Yeah.
So that is one aspect. Second, we also need to, especially as Kanishka mentioned, that in our departments, if we see most of the professors who are all the professors in my department are upper caste. So if somebody from lower caste is or marginalized section needs to see a role model from their own community, there is absolutely nobody to look at. One. Second, if they want to talk about something about their lived experiences, there is nobody to talk about. Three, even the Savarna will benefit if they understand what lived experiences of the marginalized communities are like. Right? So it is for all these points that we need to continue, not only continue with the affirmative action, but also ensure that it continues to benefit the most marginalized sections of our, even within that community.
I would just say three points. The first one being that the caste system is inherently patriarchal, so undemocratic just by completely denying women's identity independent of a man who she is connected to. So undemocratic just by definition and nature. The second thing I want to talk about, and not a long thing, but about how, you know, affirmation can be effective and good strategies to design it is a very complex thing. But also I like how you said that ideally it needs to begin at primary education, and we know how primary education works across our country and the inequality and disparity in primary education. But I think the point of affirmation is until it can organically representation is not happening. We are not achieving representation, we are not achieving equal role models from various parts of society organically or a natural way. Affirmation is our artificial fix. It's not the designed good way to do it. It's artificial and we are trying our best to fix, but it's not a cure. The last thing I want to talk about is ethical behaviors. And I think how ethical behaviors, and there are various ways it can happen, but ethical behaviors stem from is when there is no segregation. The reason why we are able to live comfortably with unethical thoughts, not being able to understand another's perspective or being so, is that genuinely, like we said in IIT Bombay, the entire faculty, what is the percentage of a lower caste faculty? So that representation affirmation also addresses that, that it helps representation, it helps more mix, a more real mix in the society, and therefore then changes and brings the ethical behavior. It becomes a group of us, it becomes a multicultural and multi-mixed group, and that's what will help the ethical behaviors come in. Not rules of morality that say that this is the ethic that I believe in, but actually living. And I think affirmation is one thing that also helps move towards that. It may not be an ideal way, but it is one of the ways.
To point out that most of the times what I'm reading is the reservation is getting connected to affirmative action. So I don't think that it is the correct way of addressing reservations, because see, if you what Tejendra has said, that he brought down the argument of constitution. So in constitution it has been stated as safeguards, right? So when you say that certain community is safeguarded, it is so that community is safeguarded against what? We know that in India there is no political majority, we still have communal majority, right? So how to address the question of communal majority? The only way democracy can work in India is through veto of power. So it is a second definition for democracy. That is how Ambedkar defines it, right? So now to bring down that veto of power, you need communities to be safeguarded, and with those safeguards only then such a veto can be executed. So giving up wishfully and willfully your safeguards is not a good thing. I mean, people may say that people might bring a reservation in moral purview, but then if you think that if you want to make the second definition of democracy to work, you have to have safeguards. You cannot just give away your safeguards.
But if we are giving up our safeguards,
can we have more voices?
Sorry, yeah.
Then we'll come back.
So, do you think that what you said, democracy against caste, in India it is democracy for caste, meaning only through a contradiction of caste democracy can work in India? Do you think that?
Kind of democracy we are living actually. So this is the democracy idea is not, it doesn't belong in the system where a caste system is there. Okay, it is Western idea where class, the society is divided on class. You can say that there is an economical parameter, but in our India is the economical. And before that, social is there. And before that, your birth, place, your different languages and prejudices comes in picture. So it's very hard to dilute every particular identity and come together and say for that we are the people of India. It is really doesn't happen in practice.
The presentation was quite concise. It presented the very complex problem in a I'll be louder. So the presentation was very concise, and it kind of presented a very complex problem quite in a very understandable manner. But I would repeat sort of a similar question which was asked earlier, that it is, isn't it the caste which has made democracy viable in this country? The all kinds of mobilizations which we see are around caste. So, I mean, how democracy is against caste in that sense? And a supplementary question to that is that all the kind of movements which have happened around caste have brought power to politicians coming from backward communities. So the question would then again be asked that when leaders coming out of such movements got the political power, the power and they became chief ministers and they got the power of the state, what have they done with it in kind of building a kind of democracy which you would prescribe?
Can we take a couple of minutes? I just want to hear more voices. This is
इतनी बात हुई है तो उस हिसाब से हम लोग का जो दृष्टिकोण है या नैरेटिव हम लोग बोलते हैं कि आरक्षण एक इंडिविजुअल के लिए नहीं है. जैसे सबसे पहला जो उन्होंने पॉइंट रखा कि आरक्षण छोड़ देना चाहिए उन लोगों को जिनके लिए वो नहीं है. मतलब एक तरह से अगर मैं खुद इंडिविजुअल की तरह देखूँ तो इट कैन बी अ राइट थिंग, बट रिजर्वेशन वॉज मेड फॉर वन इंडिविजुअल, इट वॉज मेड फॉर अ कम्युनिटी एज अ होल. तो जब आप कम्युनिटी के अपलिफ्टमेंट की बात करते हो तो उसमें एलिमेंट्स जो है कम्युनिटी का अपलिफ्टमेंट करते हैं वो इंडिविजुअल्स हो गए. तो एक तरह से इफ आई एम मेकिंग यूज ऑफ माय रिजर्वेशन या फिर आई वॉन्ट से यूज, एक तरह से जो भी हमको मिला है अगर हम लोग उसका यूज़ कर रहे हैं एंड वी कैन यूज दैट पावर टू अपलिफ्ट आवर ओन कम्युनिटी एंड दैट्स नॉट, मतलब हम लोग का वो काम है, हम लोग को वो रोल मॉडल बनना है rather than saying कि we will drop the reservation for us and किसी और के लिए use कर दे, क्योंकि वो कोई ना कोई तो use करेगा या तो अगर मेरे में capacity है उस type की मैं use कर सकूँ और उसको upliftment की अपने community के लिए use कर सकूँ तो वो ज़्यादा better way होगा rather than being a role model. जैसे एक और किसी ने कहा था role model बनना, we don't have a role model here. अगर when I'm in first year, so you are in a complex, you are not as good as general students. And I think किसी भी reservation के student को एक complex होगा और वो complex हटाने के लिए कोई मदद नहीं करता इधर कोई भी. actually कोई भी system ऐसा नहीं है जो उस चीज़ की मदद करे. अगर कोई भी बड़ी community है तो उसमें वहाँ पे you have a very big support system. अगर कोई भी जैसे यहाँ के टर्म्स में हम लोग यूज़ कर लें ऊंची जात का बंदा है तो उसके लिए बहुत ज़्यादा सपोर्ट है, बट अगर यहाँ पे जो लोअर कास्ट के बंदे दे आर नॉट ओपन इनफ तो उनकी कम्युनिटी एक्चुअली बन ही नहीं पाती है. एक भी कम्युनिटी नहीं है आईटीओ में जो उनको सपोर्ट दे सके, जो उनको वो कॉम्प्लेक्स से निकाल सके या फिर उनको अपना तरह से समझ सके. तो एक बहुत बड़ा पॉइंट है कम्युनिटी का होना. तो अगर तब तक वो कम्युनिटी ही नहीं होगी तो इंडिविजुअल कुछ नहीं कर सकता अकेले उस कम्युनिटी के लिए भी. सो कम्युनिटी एंड इंडिविजुअल दे आर गो हैंड इन हैंड. तो सबसे पहला काम तो यही होना चाहिए आई थिंक कि दे शुड बी अ कम्युनिटी एंड पीपल शुडंट बी अफ्रेड टू टॉक अबाउट देयर बैकग्राउंड जो भी यहाँ पे है.
कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन गिव्स अ रिजर्वेशन फॉर अ माइनॉरिटी रिलीजियस माइनॉरिटी एज वेल एज एससी. But in second draft, after partition which come up, if you look at constitutional debate, Muslim representatives willfully believe that Indian democracy will treat them in a better manner. And they trusted EA. But if you look at what happens to Muslim representation in India, you will understand why it is so important to hold on this reservation as a process. But one needs to also think about reservation is not just catching up, it's also important part and parcel of an representativeness. We don't talk about representativeness. If democracy is there, everyone has equal rights over institutions. It cannot be a certain people hold more or A. So one has to think in that direction rather than talking in terms of, even if what happens, more economically better person take advantage of it, quote unquote advantage. But it's important because it brings a different kinds of and diversity. So I think we also should think about, and Dalit movement, our constitution doesn't talk about the reservation, constitution numbers, if you look at debate apart from Ambedkar and some of other exceptions, they don't talk reservation as in representative one. So they talk reservation as a catching up, they are backward. So we also indulge in a same kind of an we need to move. Dalit movement has forcefully articulated reservation is not economical thing. Reservation is not something for poverty elevation, it's something for power, something for representativeness.
But now
it
works
Reservation is there for the presentation, upliftment is the side effect, and people, like when you say Bombay's, I want to mention it here, I do hear this often in many of my juniors or friends or as well, like represent reserved people, like see themselves. I feel that IITs are places, already how it functions is only for high caste people, I feel that way. So whether you are part of reservation, I see even the way how JEE functions, how the coaching centers are around as a, are functioning around to take in people towards BTEC enrollment. I see that only those people with high casteness could struggle and enter through this. And if you are questioning them in basis of high casteness, only those who come through reservation, that itself is first a wrong idea. So, and you put the sole ownership on only to those people who have come to reservation. Why are you not giving space to poor people? Let the rich people not come to general category also. Let the rich people get out of this IITs, go abroad and study, and let the poor people alone come here who cannot afford the coaching centers should enter the IITs. So that is the first narrative you have to, like, because you have made this higher education as a high caste place where poor people cannot enter, and you question the reserve people as something they are doing wrong to the poor people is fundamentally wrong first on that. And that is why reservation is only a tool of representation, never a tool of upliftment. It need not uplift. If someone asks, you have been benefited, because no, I have not been benefited if I am not here because of reservation, there will not be enough representation. So the crowd or the classroom won't be diverse enough. That is what you have to answer. So the idea of representation in the reservation is only representation. Upliftment is a long side effect which you don't even need to talk of.
Yeah. If you are from Dalit community, you will always be treated as an exception, not as a group. And to eradicate this exception, there will be all kinds of cruelty upon you. Cruelty is not part of the process here. Cruelty is the problem. Thank you.
All this problem is there any problems of here. And the caste system is not only among the Hindus, this is the Muslim community as well. And change of faith or religion has not been successful in solving this problem. So I want to know what's the ideal solution of this problem.
Action.
Okay, and as about the
point
of reservation, I won't say whether it is right or not, but let me point one thing out. So we have reservation in promotion for SC/ST people or OBC people. Idea behind reservation in administrative jobs was so that they are at the policy making level, so that they can make policies which benefit their own community. But did it help out? Unfortunately, no. So could it be possible that we are looking at the problem from a wrong angle? Why don't we demand better education? Because if you compare our caste system with the class system of medieval Europe, there is a huge similarity. There the class was all, like in our country, we can't grow out of our caste. And unfortunately, reservation, which was supposed to be a remedy, is what it is doing is it is only ascertaining the problem to a larger extent. Like somebody pointed out that once you use reservation, it is always going to stay with you always. So why not demand better education and maybe try to take not religion not so seriously? As long as religion has some sort of monopoly over your education and laws and social structure, we won't be able to come out of these shackles that hold us. And one more point, I don't know, somebody from there pointed out that there is no support system for people of SCST. I raised this question, why seek support from your own community? Why not talk to anybody who is around you and tell them and sensitize them that look, this is what I had to go through and can you please be more sensitive about it and not just judge me for my caste or community or background. So, yeah, that's
So we look at reservation in a way which is very discreet, right? So for instance, I was a part of the student mentor program which had some sort of a program for English learning. Now a lot of these students who come in from rural area sort of didn't know English. Now that primarily sort of affected their learning in classes because they didn't know instruction was English. In our we had, we also had the ARP, Academic Rehabilitation Program.
Hold it like you were holding, yeah.
Right. So, the statistics show that a lot of the students were from backward classes. For instance, reservation certainly gives them an opportunity to come to, you know, institutions like IIT, etc., etc. But I feel like, as he also said, they fail to sort of cope up with the pressure and in turn that, because like for instance, because they don't have support already, they may not be able to perform as well as the other upper caste counterparts of theirs. And in indeed, that may add to their complex that we are not as good as them, which is something that I wanted to just point out.
Om.
Om.
Shahadat.
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 I want to say a few things. One is that whenever we discuss any problem, especially when we put a demand, it's also duty on us to what can we do about it. And often there are very small things that we can do. So in this context, whenever the question is asked, where is the support group? How many people have we spoken to one-on-one? How many people have we provided them? I think that question each one of us has to answer. And I want to link it to a particular question that was said at the beginning. Sorry, I missed most of the discussion for unavoidable reasons. But talking about data, then right in the beginning, before the main speaker spoke, I think this all academic support program, the ARP, the preparatory program, were somewhat demonized. That saying this puts a label, this puts, and also not just IIT, I see other IIT, I have read a lot of articles on the web, which say the institute puts certain people in a special program, they labels. Actually, a lot of damage in my opinion, and I've been fighting this for years, talking to Adikanto, talking to other, wherever such articles have come, that have you at least looked at the data, that the people who actually were getting support going for 1 year of preparatory program, what fraction of them graduated in time, with what CPI, what career? And what fraction of the, because of all this, I would say propaganda against that preparatory program is only for the preparatory program has been reduced, scaled down a lot. And I think it has done a great harm to the cause because whatever support was there. So every support program, and I'm not saying support programs are perfect, there are a lot of problems with them. But the solution is not to close down the program, but to make them better. And by demanding data, by looking at the other thing, I was when I usually looked at my impression from whatever little data I have seen, people who avail preparatory program, actually higher fraction of them graduated on time or the average number of years of their graduation was much less than that. And similarly for ARP and other thing, I think the similar data will support. So I think that's slightly data driven, or it will show the other way, which is fine. Then also, so whichever way we see, we should try to get some data. Not in, first of all, of course, our emotions and our heart has to be right. Then we have to get the data to see whether our initial feelings are justified. But I want to raise this particular point that I do get troubled by demonizing all support programs that are put in place, and a preparatory program which was 1 year of extra work to help people acclimatize to get with the basic had been shut down, or earlier each IIT had a preparatory program, now people are sent to a different IIT and it is just significantly less in space, and I think a great damage to the cause.
Can I add something here, because in a way, you know, this remedial effort and I can only talk about my personal experience. In 2011, for close to one semester, which was the autumn semester, I was, looking after some of the English speaking upliftment, and I just did my job and I went for about a semester. In the next year, as part of the NSS initiative to improve, they called it the personality development program. Again, a lot of our students came from all backgrounds, and in a very simplistic way, data and statistics to chahiye, but that was 2011, and then 4 years later, so many of these students, when I see them, that they have graduated, because they see me and they say, ma'am this, ma'am that. And I, it's a personal satisfaction, because I believe in this so much. And yes, I have seen some of that demonization. But while maybe we can do a lot better, as an individual, I have felt tremendously fulfilled.
Master, some Ambedkar suggested that in his writing that a social intercourse or mind of people can lead the abolishing of caste system, as long as people will not able to intermingle or within from the different caste together, until unless we are not able to make a unite society, because they will be living in their own caste systems.
It seems Ranjit, I have not seen him, sorry, that's my fault. So Ranjit will have the really last word. But before that, I just want to say that for some years we have been trying to put together, it's our own failure too, some kind of open houses where IIT, the community will come and talk about it. Clearly, there is so much to talk about. If we can make this into a ongoing conversation, I think that's going to actually, what are institutionally possible, etc. are questions. Some of us tried to get some information after Aniket's death. But there is also stonewalling that happens from the institutions, because they become cagey, not because of bad faith, not because of casteism or whatever, but perhaps they don't have a language to even begin to talk about caste. There is already a given way in which caste gets to be equated with the Dalit, with the SC, etc. It's as if others are walking around without any kind of association with caste. That's not true at all. So I think institutionally we need to begin to talk and talk more, talk frequently. This has been great. Thanks for that, Ranjit will.
One thing as a communication to also said, like if this support system, etc., are to be extended to the upper caste, with all the intentions there is having the support system, etc.
No.
So, why can't we talk to the upper caste, and how should you behave? How should you respond? Like when there is a meeting happens, just shut up for something and let others speak, let others give time. Also, when you sit in an auto, like the kind of sprint you do, like let others also have space to sit, etc., etc. In our very intimate, immediate, personal spaces, our political, academic space, etc. And we have to give training and education to the upper class, I think, and the support system should be extended to them, because they are listening. I'll just say one incident, a very trivial anecdote maybe, but just a couple of days back, I was having a phone conversation with one of the professors, and the professor was saying, I was referring to a conversation the professor had with another friend of mine, and immediately the professor responded, "Don't assign this kind of a conversation talk to this guy who is not articulating." My dear professor, you just have to hold on for 30 seconds. The guy will finish his sentences, he is not very good in English, that's okay, just wait for 30 seconds, that is not going to lose anything. So that patience we have to teach the upper class professors, the students. like I took the original to the friend here said like in every religion there are caste etc. Yeah, but there is only one religion that sanctioned caste. No other religion religiously, philosophically allow caste.
Collectively try to have more of these kinds of sessions. It could just be, you know, open space somewhere. If we can do this more often, I think we will move to a better space, I think.
Right, and I mean, I don't know if blindness is the correct term to use, but I mean, I apologize. So what I mean is, it's a certain kind of language. It's a certain kind of upbringing. It's a certain kind of experience that we are brought up with from day one when we are born. And I mean, this question, where is caste, right? I mean, the moment someone asks this question, that is the example of epistemic blindness. I mean, the very fact that we are asking that question proves the point that caste exists. In that sense, in that context, Rohit's work and everything that happened post 17th Jan 2016, for many of us, it was in a sense, at least the beginnings of some people's eyes opening up for the first time. I mean, for the first time, many of us kind of woke up to the fact that, oh, there is something called caste and this is how it operates. But then, the reason I'm bringing this is to not sort of eulogize our past students for finally waking up, but what we also saw is that, I mean, over the time, if you sort of go 1 year down the line, 2 years down the line, there is another thing that started happening, which I found quite interesting. So, this I think, in my opinion, is a new form of progressive sovereign politics, where you have a lot of sovereign progressive minds, take refuge of sorts. It is not the refuge, like kind the way, you know, you take refuge in Buddhism. It's a different kind of refuge. I mean, people take refuge under, you know, an anti-caste rhetoric. I mean, so for instance, to put it very bluntly, you would have a lot of progressive upper caste students who would, you know, on every issue, they would basically say one, they have like a one-line sentence, one-line stand, that anything that Ambedkar Student Association is doing is fine, and we are no one to critique it. So this whole thing of, you know, this newly woken up upper caste, but it's kind of waking up from one nightmare into another nightmare, you know, of sorts, or waking up from one reality and getting captivated in another reality, and it kind of defeats the whole purpose of what Ambedkar is saying, what Buddha is saying, what any of the anti-caste, what Rohit himself was saying of, you know, the question of critical rationality. And I mean, so I just wanted to point that out, that I have seen a sort of section of upper caste political narrative which basically, you know, claims to be Ambedkarite, and their way of claiming Ambedkarite-ness is to basically say that everything that the Ambedkarites are saying, you know, we as upper castes cannot critique, which I think is a new form of sovereign politics, and I've seen that create, I've seen that create troubles or create, sabotage the anti-caste movement that, in a sense, you know, was sparked by Rohit's Shahadat. I just wanted to mention one more thing in response to as part of a suggestion for the series. I think, you know, so if you look at IIT, I mean, I think we should also bring back IIT into the picture, because, you know, oftentimes what happens is we sort of, you know, we get into abstractions, and it's very easy to say or very easy to take stands or very easy to articulate oneself as long as we are not naming names, as long as we are, you know, sort of in the abstraction, in the realm of abstraction. So one of the concrete points I wanted to make was, for instance, if you look at the IIT departments, I mean, the distribution of schools, you have science and technology schools, which is mostly what IIT is known for, and then you have one HSS, right? So it's as if, you know, the entire sort of, Brahminic kachra that is being generated by all the science and technology departments HSS becomes a laundromat for that. It's kind of the public laundromat jahan pe wo gande kapde dhone ke liye aana padta hai. So it should not be like that, right? I mean, so what I mean is, by doing this, we are somewhere, and this I would also sort of teach it to the HSS colleagues and students. By doing this, what we are actually, reiterating is that ek taraf objectivity hai, ek taraf technology hai, ek taraf scientific rigor hai, dusre taraf emotions hai, aur dusre taraf kya kehte hain, matlab these subjectivities and these kinds of mushy things, right? I mean, and there is a sort of, apparently there is a distinction, there should be a border between the two. I think we need to question that. I think we need to question the very idea of what is technology, what is science in a caste society. And how would our technology education, how would our science education look different according to the anti-caste thinkers, according to the anti-caste reformers, if this was, let's say, a caste-based society. If we are to build a caste-based society the way Rohit Vemula talks about, their science education, their technology education, would it still look like the technology of IITs? I don't think it would. So I think it's important to bring that question. I think it's important to question the whole idea of Brahminic masculine objectivity, and I think IIT is the perfect place to start that conversation.